My name is Bernie Evans, and I'm on the faculty in the theology department in St. John's and St. Ben's, and in the School of Theology as well. And I want to thank all of you for being here. We appreciate your coming out for this, and I think you're going to find it to be an interesting discussion tonight. We have some wonderful panelists, and we'll be getting to them in just a moment.
I want to also thank the Eugene McCarthy Center for Public Policy and Civic Engagement for sponsoring tonight's event and letting it take the direction and the focus that it's going to take. And particularly, I'd like to thank Dr. Matt Lindstrom, who is the director of that and the organizer of all this, along with Stacy Penk from his office. So thank you for doing that. And especially to give a thank you to Senator Dave Durenberger, who is here not only tonight, but he's here for a week-long residency sponsored by the McCarthy Center. And I'm especially appreciative because he has tentatively agreed to extend his week-long residency into March, in a sense, to speak at one of my class, at a class I'm teaching in the School of Theology, but it happens to be being held in Minneapolis. So he, if we can find a date, then he will be part of that discussion.
I think it works. I just thought of
that. Good. Okay. We'll make it work. Wonderful. Well, the topic tonight is one that we're all very, very conscious of. It's been so very much in the news over the last several years, particularly during the recently completed presidential political campaigns, the whole issue of healthcare was a very major one, and it continues to be that. And I think it's an issue that we're addressing tonight in terms of how do we make needed healthcare accessible to everyone in this society. And that's in large measure, I think, what much of the public debate is about. I suspect there aren't too many of us in this room who don't know somebody who is struggling with that issue in a very real, practical way, either because they don't have health insurance or because their employer doesn't provide it, or they don't have adequate income to deal with co-payments, etc. It's very much of an issue that is affecting most Americans, either directly or indirectly. The title of our panel and discussion here tonight, Faith, Ethics, and Healthcare, a Conversation, suggests a particular lens through which we're viewing this topic tonight and by which or through which we're going to approach the topic. And that is to say that as we look at and tonight talk about the issue of healthcare and healthcare reform, we're also going to be asking what does our faith and what do our moral values have to tell us about this issue and have to tell us about how we go about the task of trying to address this problem and seek solutions to its more glaring aspects. And even more specifically, we're going to be asking what does Catholic social teaching have to say about healthcare and how we might consider addressing it. So those will be pieces of what we're going to do. But basically, we'd like this to be a fairly open conversation about the present state of health of healthcare in this country, a conversation about the reform efforts, both past and present, that have been or are being attempted. We want it to be a conversation about where do we need to go and how do we get there. And we want to have it be a conversation also about how might this one particular ethical approach, Catholic social teachings, guide us in this challenge that we're facing. So I would ask all of you to prepare or be ready with any questions that relate directly or indirectly to the points that I've just raised related to the whole healthcare issue. Our plan here is that, pardon me, our panelists will each speak for something like 5 to 7 minutes. On their particular focus so that we can rather quickly get to the a more open discussion and your questions and comments that you might have about this. That's not a lot of time for people with their background and their knowledge and their experience on this topic to speak. But our plan is that they will also have the opportunity in responding to specific questions or responding to other comments to expand upon anything that they might want to address. So we're not going to have any real long-winded speeches here tonight unless they come from you folks out there, and we hope they don't. But I would also mention that we plan to end somewhere between 8 and 8:30. But no later than 8:30. All right? So I'd like to then introduce our panelists and ask them to begin our conversation tonight. First, and this is the order in which they will speak, Senator Dave Durenberger, who has been working on health care reform for more than 40 years. And he was a U.S. Senator from Minnesota from 1978 to 1995. He presently is involved in teaching at the Opus College of Business at the University of St. Thomas. And to that, I quickly add, he is a graduate of St. John's University. And some of you Johnnies in the room would particularly identify with the fact that he grew up in Flint Town. Is that accurate?
Sure.
Okay. His father at the time was the athletic director here at St. John's University. So he has a long historical attachment here. Senator Durenberger will be focusing upon the directions that are needed, that we need to go with healthcare, how we understand health policy, and some of the factors and special interests that impact our ability to get there. So that should be an interesting perspective here. Secondly speaking will be Dr. Kathy Tui. She is a professor in the Department of Nursing here at the College of St. Benedict and St. John's University, a department that she currently chairs. She received her Bachelor of Science in Nursing at the University of Maryland and her Master's in Public Health, as well as her Doctorate in Family Social Science from the University of Minnesota. And her focus here this evening will be on the need for public policy reform to ensure that the health needs of the uninsured and the underinsured, as well as other vulnerable citizens, are met. And finally, Toby Pearson is the executive director of the Catholic Health Association of Minnesota, a group of health Catholic health providers that supports access to health care and promotes the healing mission of the church. Toby was previously, and where I had much more contact with him in the past, when he worked with the National Catholic Rural Life Conference and was also on the staff of the Minnesota Catholic Conference for some years. Toby also is an alumnus of St. John's. And he will be addressing the vision of healthcare based on the moral principles expressed in Catholic social teaching and what healthcare in the United States should look like. All right, with that, I'd ask that we begin, and Senator Durenberger, would you lead us on this?
Yes, I'll be glad to. And I'll just start by saying that when I got out of the grade school, which used to be down by the cemetery and is no longer, I moved up to a seat right back in the corner over. This used to be Bede Hall because I thought I had a vocation. And so I was sitting right back there in the corner someplace just ahead of David Ammon, whose father was a doctor in St. Cloud and who became a doctor at the Mayo Clinic, as I recall. But in the back, Father Eric, our prefect, sat on an elevated platform and made sure we were disciplined. He eventually went to Puerto Rico. My job is to put a policy's perspective on this, and and I won't try to even define policy. I take 3 hours to sort of lecture an MBA course at St. Thomas on just what is policy and public policy. But usually in a society like ours, it's a process by which we define a problem which is commonly experienced, and come to a consensus on either a solution or a way to ameliorate that problem in some way over time. And unfortunately, we are living in a period of time in healthcare today in which there are so many experts in the healthcare field, including two of the people that are sitting here with me today, you know, who are in one end of the field or the other, in hospitals or doctors or nurses or insurance or something like that, that the definition of a problem is practically impossible to achieve. We can say it's universal coverage, or we can say it's quality, or we can say it's a bunch of things. But getting a consensus on what's the biggest problem, if you're in a national arena in which medicine is practiced very differently across this country, or even doing it in a state arena, in a state in which much of our hospital systems, for example, are not for profit, it's very, very difficult to drive a consensus on just what's the problem. And you can complicate that by saying Democrats sometimes have one definition of a problem and Republicans have another. But the reality is, usually we're much better at the solution than we are at the problem definition in itself. And the biggest challenge in public policy, as I think we will illustrate in our discussion tonight with all of you, and you've become, as Bernie said, the essential part of this, is how do we define the problems and how do we give them some priority? And that is our big challenge today. I'll say one thing about my wife said reading the San Francisco Chronicle today that there's a big story about how Blue Cross Blue Shield of California has just announced their new rates and for next year, and some of the individual policies are going up 40%. And one person was heard to say, now my health insurance costs more than my mortgage, you know. Mm-hmm. George Halverson, a young man from Monaga, Minnesota, who ran Health Partners in the Twin Cities for a while, now runs Kaiser Permanente in Oakland, California. And George basically said, and I say this to my two colleagues on my right, if we expect anybody who's inside the healthcare system today, who are making $2.5 trillion out of all of us, without ever having to justify how well they do it, if we expect them to change this healthcare system, it isn't going to happen because they got a pretty good thing going. Now, if we listen to the nurses or the hospitals or the long-term care, they'll say, no, we don't have a good thing going. We're not getting enough money from Medicare or Medicaid. But I just told you, $2.5 trillion. And something close to a majority of Americans are either uninsured or underinsured, meaning, you know, if something catastrophic happens to them, like just having to go to a hospital or something like that, they have to make the difficult financial choices that are really impossible. And I think Kathy's going to talk about why we need to deal with that. But I think the main point I'd like to leave you with is that the biggest challenge to change in America today is driving consensus among the people who know the most about this system, who are the people that run this system today. If we expect people that we elect, whether it's the President of the United States or congressmen or legislators or whatever it is, to solve this problem all by themselves, it isn't going to happen. And so evenings like tonight, when we try to define what are the problems and what are some of the solutions we should be exploring, are really very, very important. And it's critically important that we spend an extra amount of time. And our host here, in his little book, which I just found wonderful, I bought a whole bunch of them and passed them out to people before the election. There is no more moral mandate calling for all Catholics to agree on which issues must be addressed, on what political positions we must take, or on which candidates we should support. A well-informed conscience is our ultimate guide in these matters. That conscience is formed by the best possible understanding of complex issues by relevant church teaching and by our own passion and inclination about current happenings within our society. And I think Bernie has it exactly right. So the big challenge here is not just to President Obama, or Senator Klobuchar or something like that. The challenge really is to all of us to work at better understanding of what this challenge is. And I will say my contribution in the beginning is that unless we can find a way to reduce $2.5 trillion to something less than that, we can't afford universal access or coverage. And the other reason for reducing that growth at $2.5 trillion or $12,548 per family per year in an average premium is the fact of the matter is that we are not getting the value that those dollars should represent in whether it's physician services or hospital services or whatever it is because of the way this quote system or non-system, I guess Kathy calls it, of healthcare works. So we have a double challenge, understanding the system, you know, or the systems, and understanding the so-called politics or policy side of how do we fix it, how do we pay for it, and things like that.
Thank you. Mm-hmm. Kathy, are you ready?
I'm speaking, the kind of the context that I'm coming from here is both from I've been in nursing education for 30 plus years, but I've also been a consumer of healthcare, and in the last 2 years, a significant consumer of healthcare, and we're in trouble. And I think one of the things that the populace needs to begin to be able to do is to recognize quality care and to recognize poor quality care. Because things that I am just aghast at from a professional perspective that I see happening to patients, the patients are not reacting to because they don't know the difference. Mm-hmm. They don't know that this is an absolutely unpardonable kind of situation from a professional standpoint. So I think we've got to begin to learn how to recognize high quality care and poor quality care. And also to recognize when the vulnerable people are almost always getting poor quality care. There's an unequal distribution of the burden of illness in the poor, in the mentally ill, in the chronically ill, and there seems to be kind of an unacknowledged, an untalked about, though when you do bring it up, people will say, that's probably true, poor people get a lesser quality of care. Even in local community hospitals, especially once they're found out. You know, sometimes we try to mask. We try to make everybody middle class in healthcare. We bring them into a healthcare facility and we put the same patient gown on them. They're all middle class. Well, that's not exactly the way it is. So I think we have to focus on the unequal distribution of the burden of illness from the illness, and this is going to sound like an oxymoron, from the illness side of healthcare. We don't really have a healthcare system. We have an illness care system. Okay. Mm-hmm. And it's been rewarded tremendously. The providers who treat illness are compensated in ways, and particularly the more specialized you are compensated in ways that are very unfair. Because if we compensated the people doing healthcare or illness prevention, injury prevention, wellness promotion, we wouldn't need all those folks. And what I tell my students is nursing is about making medicine unnecessary. That's the major, for the baccalaureate prepared nurse, that's the major role, is to work yourself out of a job. That people are so healthy, they don't need medical treatment. Well, you know, that's never gonna happen. I think the other downside of what we've done over the last 30 years is that we've paid for treatment of illness and injury in our compensation insurance system We do not pay to keep people well. People who do health promotion, health education, those kinds of things, are certainly not compensated at the level of a neurologist or a neurosurgeon. They're not. So the reward system in illness care is about treating people who are sick, not preventing sickness in the first place. And that's got to be, that's just got to be changed. I think we're missing a bet, too, and part of the reimbursement system at this point. The nurse practitioner movement was about getting providers, primary care providers, into the system who were compensated at a lower level, yes, and they still are compensated at a lower level. Insurance companies are charging, or clinics are charging insurance companies for the same, many of them, the same rates as they do for medicine. So it hasn't saved the healthcare system anything. And this was supposed to be, you know, the rural accessibility to healthcare, primary care, was supposed to be strengthened by nurse practitioners, clinical nurse specialists, but the business managers in clinics are charging the same rates as they would for a physician. So there's not a savings to the healthcare system. Another system situation that I was personally part of, we spent about 4 years from 2001 to 2005 developing a nurse-managed center in central Minnesota, in St. Cloud. And this was to provide in-home support for the elderly and their caregivers to try to reduce institutionalization in nursing homes and even in assisted living. We had student nurses doing a lot of the assessments in the home, and it was about referrals and dealing with patients who were socially isolated. They needed somebody to come in. We estimated that, conservatively speaking, this nurse-managed center in 3 years of active productivity saved the healthcare system $2 to $5 million. But basic nursing care in the home, preventive health promotion, is not reimbursable. It's only reimbursable if you need an advanced practice nurse practitioner, a geriatric nurse practitioner. So the kind of work the students were doing, I mean, we wouldn't have reimbursed for students anyway. The clinic could have charged some things for that, but I mean, that's crazy. Had it closed because there was no reimbursement system. And the people in the community were just really sad. And then many of them, I'm sure, ended up in long-term care facilities quickly without that kind of support, and their caregivers too. And they would go, the students would go out two at a time, one person dealt with the caregiver, one person dealt with the older person. And so it was helping two people and keeping them on the path. So I think there's some reimbursement mechanisms that are possible and smart, but not being used. They just aren't in the system at this point. I think we've medicalized health. Health is not the same as illness treatment. And we need to provide the rewards for keeping people well, and not for treating them, not only for treating them. The rewards have to be bigger for prevention than they are for letting things happen. And I think there's some ways that public policy can affect that, but as Dave said, you know, if it's the same old people working on the problem they've created, we're gonna have the same outcome. And I don't think healthcare reform is where we need to go. I think we need to blow up the whole thing. We need to start all over. It's not just about changing what we have. We have to start all over. It's all broken. And I have a very lengthy story of my own. And I'm a healthcare person. Incidentally, that's another thing that I see regularly in the system. If you are if you're known as a healthcare person, I got preferential treatment when I was in the hospital and with my physicians. plural was particularly important. And that's not fair. That is not fair, that because I know something about health, that I should have better care. And I see it with physicians' wives, with preferential treatment for the knowledgeable is what it looks like instead of for the poor. Enough. Toby, it's your turn. I could go
Thank
on
you,
and
Kathy.
On.
And now to the system.
Yeah, boy.
Reminds me of the joke that I always tell my brother. My brother's a doctor. And I say, so what do they call the guy that got a D in med school? And he always says, what? I said, doctor. So now that we're ready to blow up the system that I represent members of.
So why?
The Catholic Health Association, actually, if we were to design a system, we set out to say, okay, what should be the core components of that system? We're not limiting ourselves to what exists right now, but instead we say, what should it be? And so the core values that we start with include the Catholic social teaching values of human dignity, pretty basic, because each person's created in the image of God, each life is sacred, people have a right to health care. Another Catholic social teaching that we believe is the common good. The health and well-being of each person is intertwined with the health and well-being of the broader community. Another core value that we would put out there is that we need to have a concern for the poor and vulnerable. As was mentioned, too often we have disparate health outcomes depending upon what your income level is, what your race is. In fact, we say the moral measure of society is how it treats the poor and vulnerable. And if you look by that measure, our society and our health care is not doing very well. When you look at the millions of people who lack access to health care, we have to be concerned about it, and we have to say it just isn't working. Another core value that we put out there is stewardship. Our societal resources are finite. We must make wise choices for how they're allocated. Healthcare resources should focus on the well-being of the community, be structured to deliver care that is most medically beneficial and promotes public health. As Senator Durenberger said, if you can't do it for, was it 2.5 trillion? How many trillion was it?
2.5.
If we can't get a control on $2.5 trillion, if we're not good stewards of our money, it's not going to work. It would just grow exponentially, and it would become unsustainable. So we have to be better stewards, using a reimbursement system that perhaps rewards preventative care instead of actually penalizing preventative care. Another core value that we would put is justice. The health care is a basic human right alongside food and shelter, all of which are necessary for individuals to fully participate in society. Again, everybody should have the right to health care. And finally, pluralism. The health care system should allow and encourage involvement of public and private sectors, including voluntary, religious, and not-for-profit organizations. Should respect the religious and ethical values of patients and healthcare providers alike. I think if we sat down and we said, are those pretty good core values to start building a system on? I think a lot of people would agree and say yes. There's, especially from a Catholic social teaching perspective, they are the primary components of what the system should look like. So then you say, well, what should it look like beyond that? Okay, we have our core values. Now what do we need? What else do we need in there? What we would propose is some simple things, like it should be available and accessible to everyone, paying special attention to the poor and vulnerable. Pretty basic. Right now, the poor and vulnerable, as it was mentioned, are getting the worst care. We think we need to take a good hard look at that. We think perhaps the preferential treatment should go to the poor and vulnerable rather than to the doctor's families and friends. I know it's an outrageous idea, but that's part of what we would say. Yeah. Mm-hmm. It's how we're measured as a society, how we treat the least amongst us. Again, we would say it should be health and prevention oriented with the goal of enhancing the health status of the communities. Again, it's health oriented rather than illness oriented. Part of the difficulty with the system we have right now is that it is set up to get the outcomes it gets, which is if you pay for procedures, you're going to get procedures. It's that simple. That's how we get paid. That's what we have to do to keep the doors open and keep people able to come in. We think it should be sufficiently and fairly financed. If you look at the way we finance our system right now, it's pretty regressive in its financing. And what I mean by that is, if I'm the CEO of the doctor of the hospital and I'm making $2 million a year, my family coverage costs me $500 a month. If I'm the nurse that works for $40,000 a year, my family coverage costs me $500 a month. Obviously, there's disparate incomes. There's higher percentage of their income that's going towards their health care costs. We need to look at that. Is that the best way to finance the system? Is that fairly financed? We also think it needs to be transparent and consensus-driven, and that's in the allocation of resources, organizing for the most cost-effective care and administration. I think sometimes some of, I wouldn't say my members, because of course they would never do such things. Some facilities out there who aren't in my membership, I think they don't do quite as good a job. I think recently there's a trend in the facilities becoming more transparent, and they're doing a better job of telling you kind of how much things cost, what the rates are, why they are the way they are. Also disclosing things like accidents. I think we're coming a long way in making it more transparent and more consensus-driven. Two more things real quickly, patient-centered. It should focus on the patient. It shouldn't focus on what the illnesses are, what the DRGs say, how much we're going to get reimbursed. We should focus more on the preventative health, overall health of patients, rather than just billing for billing's sake. And finally, it should be safe, effective, and designed to deliver the greatest possible quality. Everybody wants high quality. I think when we look around, I can say from my own personal experience, I was very thankful that, you know, Regents Hospital has one of the best burn centers in the nation. Everybody wants high quality. That includes both the physicians as well as the nurses, the practitioners, and society. So we have to look at that. So I think if we based what we wanted to build our system on, if we all agree that the current system doesn't work and we should blow it up, we think Catholic social teaching provides a pretty good stance for what the core values should be, and then builds upon those to say what it should look like. And that's what we at CHA try to advocate on the state level. And then there's also a national organization that does it on the national level. So thank you.
Thank you, Toby. If I could just a couple of quick follow-up questions, Kathy and Dave. Kathy, you seem, you're suggesting that we need to focus also, focus not just on treating the sick, but on keeping people well, mm-hmm. and let the reimbursements for that be there as well. And Dave, you're saying that, if I heard you correctly, that it'll be difficult to get consensus on how we're going to make health care accessible to everybody until we reduce the that cost of the $2.5 trillion bill. Can that be done if we, Kathy, go to move in the direction of financing or paying for health care to keep people well?
Well, we've got a backlog now. We've not done that for the last 20 or 30 years, so we've got a fairly high number of chronically ill people because we have not paid attention to. And if we don't start, we're going to just continue to have that build generation after generation after generation. So we've got kind of the double whammy at this point. We've got high costs of treatment, and we've got costs to begin to rebuild our public health infrastructure and get some prevention and some health promotion going. I think another issue that I've not heard a lot about, and it's always puzzled me why health care coverage, whatever that means, is tied to employment. You know, we're quickly approaching the point where less than 50% of Americans are employed. They're either children or they're retired. So why are we hanging on to tying it to employment? That it just doesn't make a lot of sense to me. It came out of the Social Security Act, I'm guessing, and just, no? Ken's shaking his head.
It comes out of World War II because employers couldn't give any more
dollar
increases to their employees because of government regulations, so they found other ways to compensate workers and hang on to them.
And they start hiring physicians for a while by the, at the plants, and the, you know, the various employment places, so they had their own physicians, and anyway. So I think we are in a point here where we're going to have to pay more for a while to reap some benefits 20 years down the road. And I think the other thing that we have not been adamant about is that, and this is, I think, an ethical impairment or imperative, that we are ethically bound to take good care of ourselves, to live a healthy lifestyle, to eat appropriately, to sleep, get enough sleep, to manage our stress. And I think that we owe to ourselves as well as we owe it to our families and our communities.
Okay. Dave, any comment on that?
Yeah, and I see some of the students that I've been meeting with in the room today, and I'm tempted to use some of the questions that they asked me because they're really good, and they fit this example. But and I think I told a couple of the classes that when Tom Daschle was going to be the HHS secretary, I was tasked to write a speech for President Obama about what it would be like to live in an American health system, not the one we're in currently today, but the one that actually played to the strength of American, which is we haven't done in healthcare. And it includes a lot of the things that both Kathy and Toby talked about. But component parts of that are, and this has already been mentioned, to engage patients and family in decisions about their health and their health care. That's critically important. The era in which the doctor has all the answers and we do whatever the doctor told us is over. Unless we get engaged and the doctor engages us with all the information that should be available to physicians in this area, that's a really important change. And so the decision making in that doctor-patient relationship is a mutual decision, but ultimately it's our decision, and we should have the information on which to make that decision. Secondly, 75% of the current costs in the system, if you leave out inefficiencies in the way some institutions operate for a variety of reasons, is attributable to chronic illnesses. And most of those are preventable or reversible or delayable. But in a system in which we're paying for services rather than for results, you know, we get what we get. And those costs could be reduced in half by a lot of research if, in fact, we refocused primary care, family and community health. And we refocus it on everything from oral health to behavioral health to mental health to physical health to all that sort of thing. And we re-examine the kind of people that we are asking to come to our medical school, not just the best and the brightest, but the people that got a heart. Are the people that should be in primary care, health care. And so, and we need to train them how to build a capacity to be a patient-oriented, a part of a patient-oriented group, which includes allied health professionals and ancillary professionals and so forth. They're calling it medical home, but you don't have to give it a name. It's something that's logical. And so, and on the other, the last one is we need national insurance reform to make the insurance system truly competitive, which it is not today. Last thing I will say is, if you want to see this future at work, I have a list of communities you can go to. They aren't ultimately at the future, but I will take you to La Crosse, Wisconsin. I'll take you to several other places. I'll take you to Marshfield in the area serviced by Marshfield, Wisconsin. I could take you to Appleton. In a lot of these places, like Appleton, there's a Catholic system competing with a former Lutheran system. In La Crosse, it's a former Lutheran system competing with a Mayo system. I can take you to practically all the systems in North Dakota. I think there's five large multi-specialty groups in North Dakota. I can take you to Fargo, Grand Forks, Amanda and Bismarck up to, I think, Devil's Lake or someplace like that. I could take you to Ogden, Utah. I could take you to Grand Junction, Colorado, where you can actually see the future, where physician-led organizations of multi-specialties, including a lot of health professionals that are not MD professionals, are focused on just exactly what you said, health. You know, drive down the cost of health care by everybody staying healthy. And the benefit of that is you can see the you see the financial results. Right now, if Toby's hospitals cut their costs, the benefits accrue to the Medicare program or to United Health Group or somebody like that. If the benefits of change, healthier people and better operations, stay in the communities like the ones that I talked about, then everybody can see that, and then they can enjoy it, and then they can say, wow, this is the right thing to do. And so, you know, that's none of this is rocket science. This is stuff that you can actually see that people have already come to this conclusion. But as my colleague both pointed out, none of the current payment systems have specific rewards for this kind of behavior or communities to behave like this.
Okay, thank you.
Just to add a little to that, the state of Minnesota last year went through a big process to try to come up with some health reform things, and one of them was the existence of this medical home. The hard part, though, when you get to the state level, and it's probably exponentially larger on the federal level, is when you have to balance a budget, those savings don't actually show up in the budget.
Right.
That's right.
For example, the Duluth area, they had one simple thing for heart attack patients. They had nurses calling and following up afterwards to make sure that people started monitoring their weight and making sure they take their meds. Simple phone call, no reimbursement. They saved $2.5 million to the system. But that doesn't show up anywhere because they didn't get paid for it, because the nurse making the phone call, giving them this little, little scale to stand on and say, okay, now, call us and tell us how much you weigh. Those simple things that people can do to manage their health aren't getting reimbursed. And yet we know they're the way to help contain the costs. Also, one of the hard things I hear from the systems is recruiting primary care physicians is very difficult. Mm-hmm. And the reason is because everybody that graduates from med school has a pile of debt. Well, not everybody, but a lot of the people that do.
Most people do.
And so although you may enter med school thinking you're altruistically going to go in to help all these people, by the time you're looking at your, $250,000 worth of debt, your altruism might take a back seat to making sure you can pay off your student loans before 30 years. And so then you get people who decide to specialize and subspecialize. And we need wonderful people in those specialties. I'm thankful that we have very good surgeons. But we also need to look at how we can redirect possibly some of that towards the incenting the primary care physicians as well.
Good. Well, thanks to all of you for putting a lot of ideas on the table and fuel on the fire here for conversation. Could we, I'd like to invite anybody who has any comments or thoughts or questions to start that. Do we have roving mics? Here we go.
I'll try and keep this brief. That's why I take notes. I want to thank the person here that said we're talking about sickness care, not health care, because health care is what you do to stay healthy, which I want to get on at the end here. But what I wanted to suggest here is how are we going to reshape the system? And I would strongly recommend that we make faith, ethics, and health care a theology class required for every freshman entering. And I've got four textbooks I listed already here, a DVD and one website. We need to start out with is Nutrition and Physical Degeneration, a book written in 1938 by Dr. Weston Price. Doctors write some of the best books, but I'm going to comment on that also. The other one is
excitotoxins, the taste that kills. We've also got a cookbook called Nourishing Traditions. And I would hope everybody here has seen the video or the DVD, Supersize Me.
Yeah. Oh.
If you haven't, make a point of watching that.
Right.
There's also a website called doorway.org, which or doorway with one O. But I would strongly recommend that I agree with the person that we have to completely remake this and redefine this. And it took me a while to come to this, some of these conclusions, and I'm a very prolific reader. There's another book here called Fatland, How Americans Became the Fattest People on the Planet. Because what I want to do is I want to address the cost issue. As a legislature and a doctor and anybody in the healthcare profession, how are we going to deal with these costs? Okay, so I've suggested this in conferences like this before already, the local state legislators, but I want to try and direct it back to the national level, is first of all, we have to define what is good health care. What do you do to keep yourself healthy? And there's the obvious things, you know, well, you don't smoke, you don't drink, and you avoid the risky behaviors, you know, like jogging down on the state 35 in the middle of the night, these types of things. But what we really need to address is the not so obvious risky behaviors like eating or high fructose corn syrup or aspartame in the diet drinks that doctors will actually recommend. And I want to hand them in the book, Excitotoxins, the Taste That Kills, and say, hey, we got Alzheimer's, we got Parkinson's, and we've got neurological diseases that we don't know what causes them, but then we're adding neurotoxins to our food and think we're going to lose weight with that. But anyway, I'll finish up here because what I wanted to suggest is how are we going to pay for our current sickness care? And I agree, with it'd be nice to have universal care. As it is now, I'm self-employed with a $10,000 deductible on my policy. And in the past 20 years, I believe there was 1 year where I actually got paid for some of my sickness care, even though I very seldom go to a doctor. I like to stay away from doctors because if you go to doctors and you listen to their advice, you're going to have some real problems. Well, and I'm coming off the nutrition standpoint. I grew up in an era where nutrition was touted, margarine was touted as a health food. Okay, what actually happened is if you switched to margarine over butter, you doubled your risk of heart disease. Who's going to cover these costs? So what we need to do is we need to start taxing some of these subtle dietary things like high fructose corn syrup, hydrogenated vegetable oils. That's virtually laced throughout our food. I mean, it's interesting. In 1958, research was done, and this is a Nourishing Traditions cookbook because that would be an excellent started a textbook for a class, where hydrogenated vegetable oils were implicated, and the research showed this, cancer, diabetes, heart disease, obesity, sexual dysfunction, mental illness. How can we lace our food with this? And then we wonder why our costs are so high, and why we're the fattest people on the planet. I mean, you can go back to the farm program and say, hey, thank you, farm program, for high fructose corn syrup. That's the most concentrated form of sweetener there is. But anyway, I'll quit with that because part of the restructuring should be, first of all, it's going to have to be education. And everybody here is going to have to really start learning. And my wife is always, and I'll close with a comment here. My wife is always a good one to say, you're a great one to talk. You picked up a two-can-a-day Mountain Dew and Dorito habit in college, and you went for decades like that, and she's a real healthy eater. But
all right.
Well, I keep telling her, I say, I wish someone would have told me. And so my kids are always telling me, Dad, I know that you know, I shouldn't be doing that or drinking this pop.
It's not going to happen.
But you know, it's a thing that yes, we're all involved in it.
Mm-hmm. But that's why you're emphasizing the need for education on that.
Yes.
Yeah.
Because
okay, thank you.
We've got a lot of misinformation out there. We've rewarded the food industry profitable things for lacing our food with all this junk.
Thank you.
Other comments or questions? Please.
The question I have for Kathy Tui and kind of Dave along with it is,
we're speaking about like systems level in terms of changing healthcare, but I know Dave is really big on the local level and changing healthcare. What can we do at the local level to help put input into this new change that we're looking into in terms of healthcare?
How would you define local level, Angie?
Ooh.
I mean, are you talking about like this community or St. Joe or Central Minnesota?
Well, like the example in terms of La Crosse being changing their, you know, healthcare system just in that area, that could even be a local level too. Mm-hmm. You know, even St. John's and St. Ben's campus could be even considered it from what I'm coming from.
You could start with this gentleman's suggestion about just sort of start building into the educational program. You know that my dad taught Phi Ed like forever, you know, and that sort of thing. And everybody knows that one of the first, when the schools cut back on, they get money cut back, the first thing that goes is Phi Ed and recreational programs. Let's get rid of the football team. You know, they do stuff like that. They just send all the wrong signals into the system. So, you know, part of this movement, this healthier American movement, is a recognition of the importance of education and educating parents and educating individuals and so forth. So, you know, whether that's the idea and those are the resources, I don't know, but, you know, that's a great way to start. Second thing is to look at the benefits for St. John's and St. Ben's University for their employees. To what extent do the cost of those benefits reflect nutritional, exercise, I mean, all the known healthy lifestyles? Are there any financial signals, or does everybody get the same benefit structure? Do the costs get spread across everybody in these universities the same? Or can you actually see that the healthier people, and I mean, after you factor out age and some of those kinds of factors, but I mean, you can demonstrate, it's not that hard to demonstrate. You can build into, and maybe it's already here, you can build health management programs and health fitness programs and so forth into the programs here for employees and probably for students. I mean, it's a little different here because you've got some physical facilities that you can utilize, but it can become just a part of the culture. So it isn't just the kids that are on the cross country team or, you know, whatever, the swimmers or the whoever else that's working out. But you can build this into the employees of the two universities as well. And that's just doing some of the things that we do sort of like in the little worlds in which we operate. The other part of this, which is really important to think about into the future, is this last election and this crisis we're in were like nothing we've ever gone through before. And this whole business about change you can believe in, that was a generational speaking. That wasn't a 47-year-old politician. That was a whole generation of people in their 30s and 20s and whatnot speaking in America for the very first time. I mean, instead of sitting on our homes and hands and being cynical and stuff like that, for the first time ever, we heard a whole generation of men and women of all colors, race, creeds, colors, et cetera, you know, all over the country, speaking out about change we can believe in. And in part, they talked about politicians need to change, and, you know, the culture in Washington needs to change. But at the same time, they were saying there are some of these kinds of really important values-based changes that we've been talking about here tonight that we need some leadership on. And that we, in the Collegeville community or the Stearns County community or something, we're willing to participate in a change around making this a healthier community. And so, you know, we'll provide the lead if we can get some help from the folks at St. Ben's or St. John. We're going to start, you know, working on this larger issue of improving the way in which healthcare, health, and then medical care is delivered in this community. I mean, that sounds impossible if I'm just responding to one person, but I know for a fact that leadership, you know, follows a vocal followership, and they can give you all the rationale they want about where this year we're having a tough time because the investments haven't sent them, you know, and we had to stop building the addition on the St. Cloud Hospital, and this is not the time to talk about things like this. You know, you might get that sort of stuff. But I'm talking about a different side of it. And it's the when we did the Governor's Commission on Healthcare Costs, everybody told us the way to reduce healthcare costs is to stay healthy. Everybody. And then when we met in like high school auditor or things like that, somebody would always point to the pop machine and say, get rid of that. And why does the university sponsor Mountain Dew? Because they make money. I don't know if this university does, but plenty of them do. They sponsor the pop machines because it returns, you know, $50,000, $60,000, $70,000 a year from students who can't afford tuition into the university for something or other. Get rid of it.
You know, I want to come back to Angela's question
me.
A little bit. That's okay. Because I don't want us to go away thinking that all it takes is more education, because it takes also some self-discipline. And that is the hardest part, self-denial and self-discipline. When I talk to the nursing students about their, I ask them, okay, how many of you 5 days of the week have 3 balanced meals a day? None of them do. And I said, well, what's the matter with you? Don't you know about normal nutrition? No, it's not that they don't know. It's that they don't choose to do it. They don't make themselves do it. And it is cheaper to eat junk food than it is to eat fruits and vegetables. So education is important, but there's also going to require people to say no to some things that they like to do, or say yes to some things they don't like to do, like exercise.
Two very practical examples that I can think of that are on a very local level and then also on more of a systemic level. The governor has a Fit Cities program. And one of the first Fit City was, I think it was Wabasha, Minnesota. And one of the things that the hospital did for all their employees was give them pedometers. And so they could walk around and every day they could see how many miles they walked in a day. And what this did was it kind of created a little incentive for people to be able to say, I walked 5 miles today. I did 5.2. But what they found out was while they were doing this, there was a decrease in the number of sick days used. There was an increase in the on-time rate for people getting to work. They found all kinds of secondary benefits to the simple act of giving somebody a pedometer and saying, keep track of how far you walk. Another, I think, on a higher level that we've done in the state of Minnesota is, if any of you watch TV down in the metro area, you've seen the Do campaign that Blue Cross does, where you have to do rake, do shovel, do walk, dance. Do dance, do whatever. It was funded with tobacco money, but but the benefit of that is that they are re-educating people on the need to exercise. So those are two components, if you take one from a smaller level of, you know, the microcosm of a facility doing something as simple as giving a pedometer, which, you know, the cost is minimal on giving out pedometers, to the state level of getting somebody like Blue Cross to do something like the Do campaign, which has succeeded in getting more conversation about exercise and prevention and health.
When the Service Employees International Union was debating with Fairview down there, their international representative was in talking to me because I involved her as something that on the nonprofit issues that Carol Keehan, and we had them both on the same panel, and Sister Carol Keehan is the president of the National Catholic Healthcare Association. But anyway, she came to see me and said, couldn't I do something to help it? Get Fairview to make more sense on their negotiations, their contract negotiations. And I said, well, describe for me what changes in the employee benefits structure that, just for your health benefits at Fairview, are you proposing? Particularly show me where employees are committed in exchange for those benefits to increase their health fitness and, you know, that sort of thing. And it was like, oh God, you know, we're not going to talk about stuff like that. But I was reminded of that when you mentioned what was going on in Wabasha. But I mean, it is a job is a benefit, and those fringe benefits are a substantial benefit, and particularly when you're in a healthcare organization, you ought to be a good example. And why not tie access to that benefit to some personal performance on the part of the employee?
Okay. Thank you. Please.
Thank you. My question is on the ethics side of things. Right before Christmas, my mother-in-law died, and it was the least respectful thing I've ever watched in my life. How do we put human dignity back into healthcare? Is there any way that people can... It doesn't fit well into legislation, and it certainly doesn't fit well into dollars, but there shouldn't be a cost, should there, to allowing people to have a certain level of human dignity as they're dying? How do you do that? Is there any way you can work that into the conversation? Thank you.
I think one of the things that it would need to be, it can be made part of performance appraisal. You know, that this is how we do things here, whatever our value, you know, what the values are, what the consumer expects, even if it's not particularly religious-based values. And, you know, this is, there is an ethic in healthcare, too. There's, you know, professional ethics there that should include providing patients dignity, human dignity. And I think that healthcare facility should be made known about it, possibly publicly. That's not okay care in any kind of professional provider role.
And it's obviously very challenging for our society to even face death in the first place. A lot of what we do in healthcare is trying to prevent death, which is, you know, an exercise in futility, but the outcome's predetermined. We will all die. It reminds me, I was having lunch with somebody today, and they said that we were talking about last rites and when people get last rites, and that there was one priest who was particularly known for whenever he was going in to do the anointing of the sick or doing the last rites, he would hold his book up so that he couldn't see the patient because he didn't want to see him die. I mean, so I don't think anybody's immune from it. I think a couple of things that I've seen in healthcare that are trying to help direct some of that trend in helping people die include like the hospice type of stuff where they prepare not only the individual but also the whole family for the death that's going to occur. And what they see is there's actually an uptick in their relative health for a brief time in the individual. But they also find that afterwards that all of the family and everybody that's involved has a much better sense of death and is much more comfortable with the death that occurred. It's a little movement that becomes a big movement. I think hospice is getting there. But I think as a society, we have a very hard time dealing with death in general. So that's one of those things that I think it's a core principle that we have to evaluate, getting there will be a big challenge.
This is one of those areas in which I think faith-based organizations, healthcare organizations, are really stand out and over a lot of others. My mother died Christmas Eve. She took about 6 days to die, and she died after 8 years with a dementia in a Catholic nursing home. And I'll tell you, it's almost like she didn't deserve how good a care she was getting. I mean, they were just absolutely incredible. And so I had the opposite experience from the one that that you had. The larger issue for, and it comes up in the hospice thing, because hospice was a wonderful thing. I remember being part of creating the Medicare benefit in 1984 and so forth. And we set it at a 6-month period of time, and at that time, most of the people had cancers. I mean, very easily predictable terminal illnesses. But what's happened over time is we've been better at cancer and some of these other things. It's more people that are going after the dementia business, and those are much less predictable. And so now there's a big debate in the hospice community over should we change the definitions and things like that. But the bigger cost issue and the bigger quality and humane issue is reflected in the statistics about how do we treat long-term care in this country? How do we pay for it? How do we treat it? What's the role of family? What's the role of caregiver? I mean, we look down on that caregiving profession. I mean, not those of us who've been in it, but the professionals that get to work in hospitals and save lives and things like that, they look down on the professionals that can't save lives because they're predictably coming to an end. I mean, they're coming to an end. And so all around us, we fear death. We just don't want it to happen. And that gets reflected in our caregiving culture and in how we pay for things, how we reward people. And some of us have been involved for a long time in just trying to change the system, because mainly what people need is supportive services in those when they're aging into their disabilities and when we are aging into our disabilities and all that sort of thing. We don't need to be in the medical system. We certainly do not need to go to intensive care units, you know, when we're in the last year or two of life. We don't need to see all these subspecialty surgeons. The data proves that there are, like the Mayo Clinic and other wonderful places in this country, that are just not putting people into expensive medical settings when it won't do them any good. In fact, it will hurt them. And the cost that's generated in that period of time.
And okay. Not just monetary costs.
I'm going to...
Oh, yeah, there are lots of...
I have a question back here, and I'm going to ask questioners to direct your question to one person, and we'll try to get a few more questions in that way, please.
I don't really have a question to one person. I have a comment. I am 100% committed to preventive health, preventive nutrition. Wanted to note a cautionary point is that we don't blame people who become ill and say it's because they didn't live a healthy lifestyle. We're asking then for judgments that I think are inappropriate. So prevention, any kind of health promotion we can do in any of our employment, any of our schools, but it cannot be a blaming game. We then penalize people through no fault of their own who have some kind of condition, heart problems. I just don't want to go there. Thank you.
Thank you.
This question is really for the entire panel, but it's, I guess, mostly or first directed probably to you, Dave. It's about mental health and addictions. We just recently passed, I think it was October 3rd or October 4th, the parity law for mental health and addictions. And I'm curious, just from your experience, if you could maybe, you know, not give us a top 10 Letterman list, but maybe some four or five bullets in your experience as to why it took us so long to get to that point.
Thank you. Why did it take so long to get to mental health parity? Number one, you really aren't there yet. You know, it was more than a gesture, but you know, it really, until we get a consensus in America about the rules by which insurance is going to live and what is a basic benefit to which all Americans should be entitled when they buy something called health insurance. And then everybody can buy extra stuff if they want. But there needs to be a basic benefit package. And the definitions need to include behavioral and mental health. And I'm not capable of describing the language that goes with it to make sure that we define that all appropriately. But that's a critical next step imperative. And that can only come in insurance, genuine insurance reform. The second one, I think, relates to the profession itself. And the way in which the mental health profession and other professions deal with outcomes and the conflict that exists between, again, this business of paying for services versus paying for outcomes. In the area of mental health and addictive behaviors and behavioral and so forth, it's much more difficult than it is in a broken leg or something like that to, you know, to determine, you know, what it should be for a particular outcome. But I have found in my experience, and trying to not to be judgmental at all, that one of the challenges in determining what it is you're going to pay for is that within the psychiatric professions and among psychologists and so forth, it's somewhat difficult to determine, to get a consensus about what is a better payment system than the hourly per visit or some other payment. I think everybody's agreed that having coverage for only 8 visits a year or 12 visits a year or something like that, that's not the right approach. But again, is the $150 an hour charge for whatever it is that the appropriate approach, or is there some better approach to reimbursement? I think that's the second part. Let's look at it as a national payment thing, the second challenge that we face.
Thank you.
Thank you all very much. Dr. Toohey, going back to your statement about the whole system being broke, in light of that statement, is there a future for a for-profit model of a healthcare system in the United States?
Interesting question.
Well, there are some for-profit facilities. Having been in the healthcare field through the transition from healthcare as a service to the community to healthcare as a corporation and a business, I'm much less enamored with the corporate side than I am with the community service side of it. And I know there had to be some kind of an economic, at least accountability there than there was, but I would be leery of particularly for-profit.
I think that's a really challenging question. Mm-hmm. Because I think Toby said it, something about keeping the doors open. Mm-hmm. From what I can see, they all have the same motivation, not for profit mm-hmm. or for-profit. They all have to make a profit, otherwise they can't stay in business. And the big difference is that there is a mandate which is subsidized, a mandate to care for the poor or whatever the case may be, that the not-for-profit has subsidized by not having to pay a lot of property and income and mm-hmm. and taxes like that. And the big challenge today is, you know, are they meeting that challenge? I don't think they are, generally. I don't think they could. Well, I think they could if they tried, and that's one of the reasons why I feel so strongly about sponsor organizations and the future of Catholic healthcare, because the Catholics are trying a lot harder across this country than a whole lot of other not-for-profits are. They've mm-hmm. taken the lead on national legislation, being more responsible, being more accountable, not including a lot of stuff that, you know, they share with the not-for-profits. But I do not have an answer to your question, but I think it is a whale of a good question that a lot of hospitals in particular should face up to and try to deal with more appropriately in the future.
Okay. I have a question.
Ken had a question.
All right, let me get to Ken first.
Senator, you sort of hinted at the cost of what I look at as sort of last-minute rescue care, that we spend a very substantial portion of our individual medical costs in the last couple of years of our lives trying to hang on for a few more days. We've sort of skirted around that, it seems to me. We've talked about things that we can all agree on, like we ought to be healthier, we ought to deal with chronic things. But I'd like you to, any of you who are willing to tackle this, to talk about that part of it. I mean, should we go to a British system where you say after a certain age, we're not going to pay for certain procedures?
He said your name, Dave.
Oh, he did?
Go for it.
There's kind of like, in my mind, there's like three different things here. One of them is Terry Schiavo. Mm-hmm. And now there's this case in, what'd you tell me, in Italy? Yeah. You know, those are really tough cases, and I think the Republicans were off base on that one, and I think the right decision was made.
Let's say, I mean, if I'm 80, do I get a hip replacement?
Yeah, okay. That's the one you're after? Okay.
Uh-oh. That's an example.
Hi, Kenneth. Ken's getting there. I'm going to get to I'll get to the hip. The second level down, of course, is the last 24 months of life, when it's relatively predictable. And I spoke to that a little bit, mm-hmm. and I think we would all agree that we're just over medicalizing people in that period of time. We could save money there. But to yours, I don't. It's just my basic belief system, and that is that when everybody in this country is more aware of the cost to them of their own poor health or of the waste in the medical system or all these sort of things. I don't think we're really tuned into this yet. I mean, every time these good doctors, like the doctors in Wisconsin, were reporting on themselves and how much they varied in caring for the same patient, you know, and so forth, and the variation was all over the lot, people didn't want to believe it. So, the point is, when we all get well enough informed about the consequences of both our behavior and the behavior of the system, that's the point at which, as a nation, we are going to start making those decisions. I think that's the only way we get to that one.
I just see how that deals with the last 24 months.
Oh, I thought you were talking about hips and stuff like No, I had a father-in-law who, not a father-in-law, but a one of my son's father-in-law who had a, who at 90 had a, you know, fairly serious cataract surgery. You know, Medicare paid, I don't know, $3,000, $4,000, $5,000 for it. And I thought, what in the world is this all about? I mean, he was in a nursing home. He was on his last legs, and somebody collected $5,000, some ophthalmologist collected that kind of money. And of course, I question that one, but okay, I'm sorry. Go ahead and define your question, huh?
That's fine.
Is that what you were going to ask with the hips question?
And no, yeah. I guess my question really is there, do we need to have a conversation about when do we stop trying to hang on to another few months?
As people?
As a healthcare
system. As a healthcare system.
Yeah. No, after you cure the problem of half of the kidney failure in this country doesn't have to happen. You know, half of the diabetes in this country doesn't have to happen.
But think about Kathy's point about if we know it and we don't do it.
Yeah, I understand that. I'm just saying my instinct is as long as there are other preventable, you know, big savings in this system from changing it, I don't think you're going to get people to the point where they say we don't have enough hips to go around after 80, or we don't have enough of this to go around, or something like that. I just don't think it's going to happen.
The same sort of thing happens at the beginning of life, and that one we are way far from talking about. That 98% of the healthcare dollars spent in the first year of life are for 2% of the babies, and those
octuplets.
Oh, let's not go there.
Premature.
And then that 2% that if they do survive have incredible health care costs, educational costs, family costs for the rest of that person's life, because we rescue rescue these 1 pound babies, less than 1 pound babies.
Okay, one more here.
This is a tough question.
Yeah. Oh, you can do it, Richard.
This follows up the last two questions, which I know you want to hear, and this question is to Senator Durenberger. The one word that we don't use, that's the elephant in the room that's been danced around, is rationing. And there seems to be this thought that in the United States we don't ration, whereas in Europe they ration health care. But hearing what everybody said up there, we do ration it, and it's the poor and the vulnerable that are rationed out. Now, how do we have that kind of a conversation in the country, Senator Durenberger?
Only we may have it with the next president or with the current president when he presents the case for universal coverage. I mean, and he will probably present it the way it's been presented here, that we don't have to take away from, you know, the wealthy or the chair of the nursing department who gets preferential treatment in the St. Cloud Hospital in order to take care of the poor and the disadvantaged. It's just like making the argument that we can't take care of disadvantaged kids or protect our children from being taxed by unconscionable Medicare benefits and Social Security benefits without taking away from the elderly. We don't have to take away from anybody to do the things that are right.
Oregon did have a rational, I don't know if they have it yet, they did have a system of rationing care where they would not cover things like pneumonia, which is about 100% preventable. Back surgeries, they were not covering, their medical, what is the same as our medical assistance system, would not cover back injuries because they are preventable. Most of them are preventable, you know, if it's a motor vehicle accident or something like that. But if it's a poor body mechanics or overweight, they weren't covering them.
I just want to make one or two comments on, I think we do ration care right now, as everybody pointed out. If you're poor, you don't get it, or you get it at a substandard rate. But I hesitate to say that it's purely an economic or money-driven problem, because I think that gets rid of the human component, in that the human dignity is where we start. And so you have to find a balance that places the human dignity first and also respects everybody's ability to get the care. So it can't be just a money problem of saying, well, we have $2.5 trillion, and now we just have to divvy it up, and whoever gets it, gets it, and whoever doesn't. And that means after you're 72, unless you can prove you're going to be on the professional golf tour, you don't get another hip. You don't get another hip. I think that loses the human component of health care that we, from a Catholic perspective, have to hold first and foremost as well. So it definitely is challenging, though. And to view healthcare just as a financial problem, as if it's a budget that needs to be balanced, I think runs us the risk of losing that human dignity component that, as Catholics, we cherish so much.
Thank you. One question I'd like to ask is that, in the midst of all this, and given the fact that we've talked a good bit about education and about personal choices and lifestyle options that we all should be thinking about and making good choices in that area. In addition to that, what one or two things would any of you recommend that we do in terms of advocacy to move towards a reformed healthcare system that might point towards everybody in this country having access to healthcare when it's needed? What kind of, I know I don't mean the whole big thing, but if we're going to get there in steps, and given where we are in the country in terms of the political situation today, can you name one or two things that we ought to be advocating for politically?
Well, it's a little challenging in that, but I will get around to suggesting one or two things. The practical reality, as the senator could point out for us, is that if we were talking about the farm bill or transportation, we'd have a pretty good voice to go to in Minnesota, in that Oberstar is the chair of the transportation and Peterson is the chair of the farm. In Minnesota, we don't have somebody that's the chair of the Health and Human Services Committee on the national level. So that is a bit of a difficulty for us, but that doesn't mean that we can abdicate our responsibility to make our voices heard at the same time. Right now we have one senator, Klobuchar, and I'm sure she's hearing all about it. But on a very practical level, in the state, I think, is this Larry Hosh's district, Representative Hosh's mm-hmm. district? He's, he was the vice chair of the Health and Human Services Finance in the House. Now he's in leadership in the House. So writing a letter, making a phone call to Larry and saying, it's really important that we deal with this issue.